chance or design. Discover the mysteries of life. At Seventh-day Adventists, we are on the forefront of the creation debate. Blessed, when she was in college for nursing, one of her professors, and they were talking about creation, evolution, and finally, after going back and forth, he said, "What church do you go to?" "Oh, I go to Seventh-day Adventist Church." "Oh, you guys are hard ones." And we should be, right? I mean, why even be a Christian, never mind a Seventh-day Adventist, if there's no creation, if there's no creator? That we solemnly believe in a six, seven-day creation story. God created in 6 days, rest on the seventh day, a loving God. And creation and redemption are intertwined. He created us and he redeemed us. And we have the Sabbath day. We have the new earth coming. So this is a sermon on creation. On your vacation, you decide to go to the beach. And after a while, you start poking through some of the nearby stores and gift shops. And some of them have little cheap trinkets, little tourist trap things for you to go. But after a while, you come to one that is stocked with these beautiful creations of glass and bronze. The local artists put them together, stone, good sculptures. And you look at the intricacy of the creativity of those artists, and you wonder how wonderful that is. And you look at the price tags, and it's like, oh, a little pricey. But there's one piece that just especially catches your eye. You talk to the shop owner, and you say, Who made this? What's the artist's name? Oh, nobody made anything in here at all. We had an explosion a while back in this building, and when we came in afterward, everything is just as you see it. You're looking at it, and you start wondering, okay, really? Because we all know that when you have a creation, right, you need to have a what? Someone who created it. Right? If there's a design, you need a designer. At the turn of the 19th century, Napoleon and his army were traveling over the Mediterranean Sea to conquer Egypt. And one starry night, they were out on the deck, and Napoleon's pacing back and forth. His men are down, and products of the French Revolution, they were actually having a who could prove the best there was no God. And they're all trying to outdo each other. And Napoleon's walking back and forth, and he's listening to what they're saying. And finally, one of them said to him, what do you think? What do you think about what we're saying? And he said to them, well, very good. But then he pointed up, and he said, look at all them. Who made them, and who sustains them? Good question, isn't it? Those beautiful stars looking down on them. Who made all those? So who made this world and who made the billions of stars? Who charts their course and keeps them in that course? Astronomers, they can tell things in the future because all the stars and the planets all are in an orderly pattern. So they can tell when the next eclipse will be, when the next this will be, because God made it that way. Many gods have been worshipped all through history, all through the ages. Many people have been taught there is no God, that there's no creator in anything we see. Many of them believe in what Darwin taught, a theory called evolution that teaches the children of the world that the cosmos came into being by a series of chances that took place over billions of years. This theory of origins teaches that once the first cell was formed, that through many biological and geological changes, the marvelous universe came about. Blind chance and miraculous changes account for this intricate universe that we live in and see all about us. Can this marvelous universe just simply be a product of natural changes by chance? No, we see that's not true. That it was not some supreme intelligence who designed it, or that just randomly happened? Is this random chance? No, it's not, is it? No, it's not. I heard one pastor say, we wonder why the kids in school are so messed up. First period in the morning, they go to science class, they're taught that there's no purpose in life, we're here by accident, and there's no real design, and It's just chemicals and apes and frogs and tadpoles. And second period, they're running to the psychiatrist at the school because they're all messed up with no purpose in their life. Right? There is a purpose. God created us. And we'll learn more about that here in just a few minutes. As we examine the intricate design of almost everything that we see on the earth and in the universe, we conclude that there is an intelligence at work in the creation and design of this world, and also in sustaining it. The one who created it sustained it. That master designer is who? God, Jesus. Let's find out more about him. So where should we start in our search for the handiwork of God? Let's see what the psalmist says about what happened when man was created. He says, I will praise you, for I am fearfully and what? Wonderfully made. We are fearfully made. The human body is just an amazing machine, isn't it? Maybe I should say amazing organism might be better. And we are wonderfully made, right? Blink, we can move, we can breathe, we can feel, we can love. So we are wonderfully made, a wonderful creation. God's crowning act of creation was Adam and Eve. Eve might have been the frosting on the cake, if I can put it that way. The design of the human body demands the existence of a designer. Ever wondered about just seeing all that is involved in the eye? Scientists tell us that the delicate engineering of the eye's cornea and lens is the most advanced camera, makes those the most advanced cameras seem like child's toy in comparison. We have tiny rods and cones in our eyes that change light into electrochemical impulses through processes even the most sophisticated laboratory cannot duplicate. Brain cells transform those electrical impulses into the miracle of seeing. Darwin once said, this is what he said, Darwin once said that the thought of the eye and how it could possibly be produced by natural selection made him ill. Well, here's why. The human eye could not have evolved over long periods of time because it's absolutely useless unless complete, right? This morning on 3ABN, John Bradshaw was there talking about India and doing surgeries for cataracts in India. So even something as cataracts can make people go blind. So the eye had to be complete. So we need the lens, which focuses the light. It would be useless without the retina that senses light. Vision involves a complete system of organs, all interrelated, all thoroughly designed, and that's the way the human body is. All parts what? All our parts perform incredible, complicated tasks. It's just not the eye. What about the circulatory system if that wasn't set? What about the nervous system? What about the digestive system? What about the reproduction system? The skeletal system? There's probably others I'm missing. That's off the top of my head. Say one of those is missing or incomplete. Say the digestive system wasn't right. Say the nervous system wasn't right. What would have happened if Adam and Eve were not a complete product? See, the human race is not like our creator is not like Microsoft, always sending patches and fixes, right? I did a 5-hour update the other day to update Windows 10 because they have to keep making it better. But when God was finished with Adam and Eve, they were a complete product. They were perfect. Everything was perfect. So we have a perfect creator who understood how to make an ecosystem day by day, 6 days for man, perfect for us. And then he created Adam and Eve. You remember what God said? Let us make man in our image according to our what? Likeness. Made in the image of God. Do we have value? Absolutely. We have value. We come from the hand of a loving creator. That gives us worth. Right there, that gives us worth. It was an all-wise, caring God who gave man those two eyes to help him in seeing the wonders of his creation. What about the creation of our universe? What evidence do we have that God designed the entire universe? There's a prominent scholar named Philip Johnson, a professor at Berkeley University, and here's what he says about Darwin and evolution. Now, He wrote this book a little while back. It had been 140 years since Darwin introduced his theory to the world. And what do we have to show for it? Is that a good question? Yes. You know what? I get frustrated when they find some dinosaur fossil that maybe may have had a hand. They think it might have been a hand, and it's all over the news for a couple days. They never hear about it again. Or some lizard that might have had, they thought had wings. That might have been one of those bridge things after the evolution from one creature to another, and then you never hear about it again. They're desperate to find something. What do they have to show for it? That's a good question. For all the brave talk about evolution as an established fact, much of the evidence actually seems to run against Darwinism. As, for example, fossils that don't show creatures gradually changing, but rather staying the same. And that's why we have those fossils, when they think they may be a bridge between two different, through evolution, it just never comes back, and you never hear about it again. Yet Darwinists so want the theory to be true, they obscure the evidence. Just when and where will Darwinists demonstrate that one species typically becomes something completely different? Who has seen that? No one. Will you see it? No, we don't believe so. They would have been found by now. Is there any evidence, Johnson asks, that what they say must have happened did in fact happen? Well, they haven't produced it yet. They haven't produced it yet. Isaiah, the gospel prophet, challenges all of us to take our eyes off the little things of the universe and focus them on what God did in the sky. This is what Isaiah says, lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things, who brings out their host by number. He calls them all by name, by the greatness of his might and the strength of his power. Not one of them is missing. So he says, look up. Look at all the host of heaven, all the stars of heaven. Who brought those about? That's a good question, isn't it? Well, we know who created everything. Jesus did. Now, before the invention of the telescope, they would sit out and they would try to count the stars to see how many stars there were. And for what they could see with the eye, they came to the conclusion there was 5,110 stars from what they could just see. Well, we kind of laugh, you know, but with the eye, I can even keeping track of that many is amazing. That's what they thought. But here's what the Bible says in Jeremiah 33, verse 22. The host of heaven cannot be what? Numbered. And that was centuries before a telescope. And Jeremiah saying, the stars cannot be numbered. Amazing, isn't it, that the Bible was right. As we look at the Milky Way, you are looking at the edge of our galaxy, a star system shaped like a saucer, and I put in those nebula around just to add some variety of what is really out there. The Hubble telescope, honestly, has been just a godsend for us just to see what God has done in the sky, and they just keep going deeper and deeper and deeper into space, and it's going to keep going to see that God really did stretch out the heavens, that he's the one who made them. It's just amazing things out there. As we look at the Milky Way and all the things that they're finding. Astronomer Fritz Kahn says, our home in the universe is a spiral of 200 billion stars, a unit of suns whirling through space like a fiery pinwheel. So every 24 hours, our galaxy travels 1.5 million miles through space at more than 66,000 miles per hour. It's amazing what God has done in the universe. He says all creation witnesses to the God, to the deity of God as we look at creation and nature. The huge 200-inch Hale reflector on Palomar Mountain can see as many as 1 million galaxies inside the bowl of the Big Dipper alone. That's from National Geographic. Of how many? 1 million galaxies. That is quite a number. And the Hubble telescope is able to make these statistics obsolete as we look at the Hubble telescope. The discoveries made by this telescope have cast serious doubts on the scientific guesses made in the past. Now, scientists have now detected light that started on its way through space 38 billion light years ago. Okay, 38 billion light years, which only proves that just as time is endless, space has no limits. Our God made a vast universe. What a designer. Yet God gave an illustration that helps us comprehend a little better the immensity of it all. God once took Abraham outdoors, and he challenged him to what? Count the stars. Count the stars. It must have been one of those starry nights. Like we had this the last week. We didn't have much, and the moon wasn't up, and I would out walk at night, look up, and I just see that shaft of light of the Milky Way. It's amazing. Sometimes I just feel so close, I could just go like this and just sweep a bunch of stars in my hand and stuff them in my pocket. He said, count the stars. And what did he tell Abraham? Your descendants will be like the stars of heaven. The stars of heaven. Even that witnesses to us that there's going to be billions of people on the new earth. Billions. That's why there's no more sea. There's rivers, lakes, and ponds because God needs the land for us. That's why there's no more seas. It's all about people. So if the stars, billions of them, are a witness that God's kingdom will be filled with people, why can't we be part of that kingdom? Right? What's keeping us from being part of that kingdom? Why can't we be numbered part of that kingdom? We're no different than anybody else. We're all humans. We all have the same chance to get in through Jesus, right? So what's keeping us out? Pride, selfishness. But God is a God who can create in you a clean heart, right? That's the beauty. So if there's any lack in us not to make it, we can come to God through Jesus. And that was our Sabbath school lesson, justification this week, that God will accept us in the family when we repent and come to him and ask him and to take Jesus as our Savior. So count the stars, and one of those is named after you. You know, people like to have a star named after them. Well, maybe God has named a star after you already, knowing you're going to be in the kingdom. So have you ever wondered if a powerful God who rules and sustains a vast universe is actually concerned about man and the problems on the earth? That's a big question. Does God really care? Well, here's what the Bible says. Yeah, Jesus said that not even a sparrow falls to the ground that God does not what? Notice. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. So we can't be afraid. Amen? God is for us. Who can be against us? Now, the question now is, what right does God, the God of the Christians, have to claim that he should be the only one worshipped, exclusive worship by everybody? Well, John, as he was on Patmos, had the vision. We call him John the Revelator. And he had a heavenly throne room vision. And here's what he saw. Notice, the 24 elders fell down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you, what? Created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. God created all things. That's what gives him the right to be worshipped. He's the Father. He's the Creator. And in the first angel's message, fear God, give glory to him for the hour of his judgment to come, and worship him who made heaven, earth, and the springs of water. So it's a call back in these last days to the Creator, to the one who made us, the one who wants to redeem us. So that's the reason why we worship him. He made it all. We are his. We are his children. So the elders before the throne are praising God for this simple fact, he's the Creator. And this is the same reason why we worship the God of heaven alone. Now, when the Father was working, he was not alone. He had a helper. He had a partner. Here's what the Bible says. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. without him, nothing was made that was made. Everything was made by Jesus. God made it through Jesus. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Full of grace and truth. So Jesus, the Creator, also became a what? A human, so that he could redeem us and give us a recreation and a new birth. So creation goes two ways. Creation in the beginning, and then when you give your heart to Jesus and are born again, you are a new creation, fashioned from the hands of your Creator. They continue on here in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9. It says that the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ. So every good and perfect gift that man has or ever will have come into being because of the Godhead. They were united in their creation and in their blessing of the human race. So not only did God make man in his image, he also gave him a beautiful universe to live in, a beautiful planet to live on. And he was also mindful of man's needs. Psalms chapter 145, verses 15 and 16. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand to satisfy the desires of every living thing. Does that include you? Are you? Yes, that includes you. So God is, he cares about you, and he loves you. So let's take a look at the few ways that God cares for the needs of his creatures. Consider the water we drink. It's as old as the pyramids, or as I say, older than the hills, as old as the hills. Now, water gets polluted with chemicals, but let it what? The sunshine on it, it evaporates, goes up into the clouds, and what is the condition of the water as it evaporates up into the clouds? It's pure, and then it comes back down as dew, rain, or snow. God designed a tremendous water system for us. What about what God put in the sky with the sun? Think for a moment. Say it was a little bigger or a little closer to the earth. What would happen to the earth? It would burn up. The oil, the oceans would boil away. Say it was a little smaller or a little further. What would happen to the earth? Yeah, it would be frozen like many of the other planets that are beyond us. It would freeze. So either way, life would not exist. God placed the earth at the proper distance from the sun. Did that happen by chance? No way. No way. Job tells us about the air we breathe. That's a gift of God. In his hand is the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind. So in his hand is your life. Your life is in his hand. Amen? And your breath is in his hand. So God designed the universe, and he knew just the right formula for the air we breathe to sustain us. He knew the right amount of nitrogen, oxygen, argon, carbon dioxide to mix into the atmosphere, and that just couldn't happen by chance. It couldn't happen by chance. There's no way. God didn't create this beautiful planet and this magnificent universe in vain. He created it for beings who could appreciate and enjoy it. That's why he made it for us to enjoy. And that's what it means when the Bible says he created it not in vain. He formed it to be what? Inhabited. He made it for us, a gift for us. And someday he's going to make a new earth. Amen? It would be tremendously more beautiful than this one because of sin. Now, look at the wonders of the world. Think about migration. And the birds who travel, already the geese are starting to come by. What about the hummingbirds? Weighing less than an ounce, and they'll fly thousands of miles nonstop to a destination they've never seen. Job says here, but ask the animals, and they will teach you, or the birds of the air, and they will tell you, or speak to the earth, and it will teach you, or let the fish of the sea inform you. Which of all these does not know that the Lord has done this? So nature testifies to the handiwork of God. So God did do it all. In fact, our our duty and privilege to worship God is based on the fact that He's our Creator. Out of appreciation, we worship Him. And all things owe their existence to Him. Psalms 100, verse 3. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us. We are His people. God has made us, and we are His. We are His people. The sheep of His what? Pasture. So God knows our needs. Amen? And He has a power to supply those needs. That's why we pray, give us this day our daily bread. God will supply all they need according to His glory and riches by Christ Jesus. So this is going to give you peace of mind that God can handle everything that's going on in your life. Isn't that true? In the universe, that God can handle it all. No problem is too small for the God who made these galaxies. He knows everything, and He even knows it all ahead of time. He says, "For I am God, and there is none like me," declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done. So He knows the future. So do we fear for the future? Not if God's with us. If God is with us, we don't. So this gives us peace of mind and confidence, knowing that nothing can happen to us that's not too hard for God to take care of. He has a long, strong arm. Jesus said, "The Father Himself loves you." Now, I don't know when the last time you were told God loves you. I want to tell you today, God loves you, as if there's not another person on this planet. He has the hair of your head numbered, meaning He has all the details of your life under control. He's aware of it. And we just connect with Him and cast our burdens on Him because He cares for us. He cares for us. So does it surprise you that a mighty God who created and sustains all this colossal universe is concerned about you? It should not be a surprise. Just contemplate the wisdom of God and everything He has made and the love that He has for us. And there is nothing in the world that can separate us from God's love. Here's what it says. I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So the one who created us is the one who is with us. Nothing can separate you. Death, no powers, no demons, nothing can separate you from God. He has promised to never leave us nor forsake us. So we worship a loving, caring Creator. And He's worthy of worship not just because He's the Creator, but also He's the God of love, who is what? Interested in our lives. So He's not on a power trip. He's actually on a love trip. He's trying to love us into His kingdom. Amen? So remember, we're not alone. We have a powerful God. Let's have a word of prayer. Loving Father in heaven, thank You so much, dear Lord, for Your goodness, for the creation, for the recreation. We just give our hearts to You afresh today. Help us, Lord. We're all struggling. We all have our trials. Dennis asked about prayer and hands went up. Lord, probably some of us could put up both hands. But we know that we are not alone. You are there with us. You are walking with us. You came to seek and save the lost.